Thank you very much. Once again, a very good morning to everybody, and thank you for coming. My name is Luzu Koch-Jacobs. You are here to attend the press briefing to be addressed by the presiding officers of the National Assembly, whom I'm going to introduce you just now, to reflect on what happened in the chamber yesterday, continuing through the night. In the middle, at the table, we have got the Speaker of the National Assembly, Ms. Baleka Mbete, and to her right, we have got the Deputy Speaker of the National Assembly, Mr. Letshisa Tsenodi. And on the left-hand side of the Speaker, we have got the House Chairperson, Mr. Cedric Frolic. The Acting Secretary to Parliament is seated right next to me here. She is Ms. Baby Kiawa, and next to her is the Acting Deputy Secretary to Parliament, Advocate Modibedi Pindela. The House Secretary to the National Assembly, Mr. Masibule Lekhaso, is seated just behind Advocate Pindela. Without any waste of time, I'm going to invite the Speaker of the National Assembly, Ms. Baleka Mbete, to address us. Honorable Speaker.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen of the media, any colleagues who might be here, honorable members of parliament, ladies and gentlemen. I want to do two things, speak to two things. One would focus on yesterday and give you a context of the events that then unfolded in the House. The second thing I would want to do is to perhaps just very briefly sketch a picture of the past 5 months in relation to what you also saw yesterday, and give you again some commentary and some background to what was being expressed at yesterday's sitting. Yesterday was a Thursday, and therefore at 8:30 in the morning we had the usual National Assembly Program Committee, which is chaired by the Speaker. But on the eve of that meeting was a Chief Whip's Forum usual meeting where the whips, you know, process the issues of programming among themselves. That's a multi-party forum. The discussion continued into the National Assembly Program Committee, in particular relating to the order of the issues that would be on the order paper. Now, only one thing for me is very specifically relevant to what then later took place, and that is the issue of clearly what was going to be a very long day. In fact, I remember that one honorable member who's a senior whip came straight to me from an opposition party and expressed great frustration, and I was saying, why? He greeted and he expressed frustration. I said, why? He then made reference to something that had just become clear to him, which he hadn't realized the day before. And that was the number of reports, the what we call budgetary review recommendation reports. So this issue of the length of time yesterday's sitting was likely to end up in was an issue that preoccupied me as I left the meeting yesterday morning. By afternoon, I had decided that, you know, if you are going to have 38 BRR reports and every party was going to express itself, or you were going to end up with some debates, were going to be there the whole night. Hence the issue of trying to manage the issue of time. Because you always start in the day with notices of motions and motions without notice, and those are generally unlimited. So what I proposed, which is what that ruling was about, was that let's agree some time in order that we have a way of limiting this first part of the program. Because all the other items were also going to take very long, including the discussion on the report on the from the ad hoc committee that was chaired by Honorable Frolic. So this was, in fact, the point at a later stage that the parties also agreed. There was no way we were going to be able to manage time if we were going to debate all those reports. All those, in fact, in the end, there were 40 of them. So we ended up actually where I had started to try and assist the House. And in fact, we ended up by debating only the issue relating to the treaty between South Africa and the DRC relating to the Inga Dam project. So I want to just leave the issues relating to yesterday's events there, because you probably have some information. The only thing I was doing was to give you a context, to give you some background so you understand what in fact was the issue of agitation, and that's what it was. The second thing which I want to pass on to relates to an observation we've been making, both from the executive authority side and from the side of the parliamentary service and those that assist us in the work that we lead here in parliament. This parliament is not yet 6 months. It's not yet 6 months. Because if you remember, we took our oath on the 21st of May. We then went away, as we always do, and we came back to listen to the State of the Nation address. And therefore, the first debate, the first formal official sitting in terms of members, you know, listening to somebody, saying something to them, and then having a debate, was in June. It was actually, to be specific, on the 17th of June. It was in that debate that the trend we have been observing started to show. And honorable people who are here will of course be aware that on that occasion, the chairperson of the National Council of Provinces had reason to actually ask some honorable members to leave the House. That was the first time in this fifth parliament. That trend has continued, and in fact, honorable members have actually said very clearly in public that they have the intention of disobeying and not cooperating with the rules and so on. So that's in fact the trend we have observed, and yesterday was one of many occasions when this sort of conduct, which is predetermined before people come to the House because of course they are pursuing a particular approach that they have taken and they've actually expressed themselves on. in public. No amount of trying to accommodate honorable members has helped. No amount of invoking rules has helped. I think definitely recently, in fact last week, a voice that represents very strongly that trend has said we have no intention of cooperating. We will continue to disregard rulings. We will continue to disregard the rules. Now, Parliament is a place that works on the basis that there are certain agreed norms. There are certain agreed assumptions that all of us who come here are committing ourselves to, including the fact that we come to Parliament as people being sent through an election exercise. And we take one another as honorable members, arrive in this institution, in fact, commit ourselves through many structures that we work in, like, for instance, I made reference to you to the Chief Whip's Forum, which is a consensus-building mechanism of Parliament, which has always been respected, which always helps to make sure that we're all brought on board and together we pursue things in an agreed fashion, also as based on the rules of Parliament. Now, if you arrive and you say you are not going to respect the rules, you obviously are not in a place where you should be coming, because we come together based on an assumption that we all respect the rules until such time that we all go through a process where we agree that we need to change this rule in this way and that way. And therefore, none of us must just on our feet express ourselves or change the rules and assume that all will be well. And I think yesterday showed us what happens when you disregard the norms, when you disregard the rules, when you don't want to cooperate and you actually go all out to be disruptive and not to play according to rules of working together, which in the past four parliaments, it's not the first time I'm speaker, if people can remember. I was speaker in the third parliament, and we worked very well. And we did differ, because differing is something that happens, not even in a family, people differ. So difference is not the issue. But to take a determined, conscious position that you will not agree, you will not respect, you will not cooperate, and we have seen it ourselves. Because if you ask people who preside, they will all tell you the same thing. The frustration of trying to manage a situation where people are going all out and they are saying it, that they are not here to cooperate. And of course, we are bound by a way of doing things that we have always followed. And we go all out to make sure we accommodate every honorable member. We make sure that they have the opportunity. Even many times yesterday, you saw honorable members getting up and for more than 3 hours, honorable members were filibustering. They were wasting as much time as possible in that first part of the program of the House. And so we have no illusion whatsoever. Even when we reached the point which we had resisted for a long time in these 5 months that we have gone through. What the law actually allows us finally happened yesterday. Because yesterday was a culmination of a long time of, you know, appealing to honorable members, trying to show them that it's okay to differ, but there are ways according to the rules that you can express the difference that you need or you want to express. And it was so obvious when the honorable member was standing at the podium. She even put her arms on the podium, making it very clear that she wants to instigate, she wants to provoke something, which is in keeping with what had been publicly declared. So I thought I should just give you that background around those 2 points, and then I think I should hand over to Luzuko. I'm sure there'll be some questions, and then we will, the three of us, and whoever else has information that might be in a better position to clarify things to you, in particular the secretariat. There's a Madam Acting Secretary and the House Secretaries. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Honorable Speaker. Speaker has given us direction about what to follow, which is an opportunity to members of the media to ask questions for clarification in relation to the issues that the Speaker has addressed. So we'll take a round of questions, which the Presiding Officers will note, and as Speaker has indicated, the Presiding Officers will assist each other, assisted by the Secretariat also, to answer those questions. So we'll take 5 questions at a go. We've got 4 hands up. Mr. Kalata, you first. Paula, in that order. Yes. So can you just please identify yourself and the media house that you represent and ask your question, please?
All right. Thank you very much. Good morning, ma'am. My name is Lukanyo Kalata. I work for SABC. On the 21st of August, when we saw the disruption that happened, you had then referred certain members to be charged by the Powers and Privileges Committee. Is there a likelihood that you are going to take the same action again based on yesterday's events? Is that something that you're considering? Thanks very much.
Thanks, Mr. Kalata, for sticking to one question. Can we just emulate Mr. Kalata in that respect? One question per person at a time, please. Paula?
Okay, well then I'll start with Paula Charles, ENCA. I'll start with the fact that as the incident happened where MPs were forcibly removed and police were brought into the chamber, the parliamentary feed, so that sound and audio, was cut. Who makes that call? And why was that call made? And is that not censorship?
Good morning, Bianca Capizorio from the Sunday Times. I would just like to know who was the person who made the call for the riot police to come in, and following on from that, whether that level of force was necessary for one person.
Yes.
Following on, Janet Heard, Media 24 Newspapers. Following on that, can you explain whoever made this decision? I understand it's the Speaker who has to make that decision. Can you explain on what grounds, if so, it was made?
Okay, thank you very much. We have the first batch of questions, and we'll now afford the Presiding Officers an opportunity to take some of the questions and for the Secretariat to assist with the relevant questions.
I'm not sure I heard all the questions. Okay, let me start with whether we will take action and how on the 21st we had referred the matter to powers and privileges. At this point, as you will appreciate, we have not had those discussions, you know, as the institution from different, I mean, we are now meeting here before you just so we can give you an understanding or give you a context, but we're still actually going to go and sit and analyze in depth, you know, from different angles, from the point of view of people who work in this institution and what from where they were, they saw what happened. And we will analyze together, and then we can determine a course of action. The issue of who decided on the police, it's actually a detail, but I'll leave the head of security to deal with that. But I want to say the following. I said earlier on when I was addressing you that all along, we have resisted, in spite of us having a law that gives us the authority, indeed, to call the police. Like they are also called into a court to remove anyone who's disruptive. We could not sit here in this institution and forever allow disruptions and outrageous conduct of honorable members who have come here not to work as we all do, but to come here and just push the boundaries in the process to rubbish this institution of the people. So I want to make that very clear. When the police were called, it is precisely because it's not that we were not aware that the law allows us to do that. It's not that we were not aware, but we resisted it. We did not want to go to that length because it had never happened. We had never had reason to call the police. So I think it must be understood that it is incident after incident, it is how the people that have to play certain roles apply their minds after each incident and look at those measures and mechanisms that are there at their disposal to protect the dignity of Parliament, to protect the work, the business of the House being protected, so we continue. From the first, no, it wasn't the first, it was the second in August. If there was something that we were all preoccupied with is, please, can these honorable members be assisted to leave the House so we can continue with the business of the House? That's what is paramount in our minds. And there's no way we're going to allow ourselves to come here and each time just be disrupted and as if this place is to just come and have a lot of drama. But I think, Zelda, you might want to come in on this one.
Thanks, Madam Speaker. Just briefly on the question as to who called the question was the riot police. I just want to correct the issue there. The Parliament, the presiding officers, and the committees are supported by Parliament Protection Services and the police. You would notice that we always have a police presence on the precinct. So the police wouldn't be called in specifically. The police are present on the precinct. And they perform functions as prescribed in the Act and in terms of their mandate. Yesterday, the sergeant at arms was called on by the House Chairperson to remove the member who was not following an order to leave the House. The sergeant at arms appealed to the member to leave the House. Failing that, on several occasions when that negotiations or diplomatic engagement failed to yield the result, the sergeant at arms stepped out and called on the services, on the assistance of the protection services. Now, let me just explain what that protection services entail. It entails Parliament Protection Services and the South African Police. In the South African Police component, there are different units supporting Parliament Protection Services. That's a joint command. There is no riot police in the South African Police Service. I just should correct that. And there's a public order police unit. But the component consists of those components of the South African Police who work jointly with Parliament Protection Services, and the sergeant at arms sought the assistance of Parliament Protection Unit. And they did that at her request to assist on the instruction that a member be removed who failed to leave the House in order to do so. Thank you.
Sorry, I may inadvertently not introduce Ms. Zelda Holtzman, who's just spoken now, just for the record and for those who might not know. Ms. Zelda Holtzman is the head of Parliamentary Protection Services. Okay. I don't think the full round of questions has been answered. If we can just complete that before we take the next round.
Can we just, to the extent that censorship specifically has been mentioned, we are still to get the detail of what happened and what action was taken, at which point. You will remember even on the occasion of August, I was told that the media were harassed and so on, and really we were hearing those things for the first time. So, but your question is whether how the issue of the cameras and the images was handled, whether it is not censorship. I guess on issues of that nature, you will always have a bit of both, because from one point, we are looking at ensuring that we protect the image and the dignity of Parliament. That's all we're preoccupied with. We're protecting our right to proceed with the work that we're doing, that we've come or have been sent to come and do here. What exactly happened, as I said, we will still sit and get reports from various angles and take the issue further. But we don't have a policy of censorship. We all know the attitude of our democracy on those matters, but all those issues have limitations. And even in the Bill of Rights, those limitations are clearly pointed out, that there isn't one element from which there's an endless right or a heightened right that is more than other rights. But that Parliament is here for a purpose, and that purpose has to be protected and pursued.
Zelda, I think those are four lines. I think because there's an assumption that the powers and privileges and immunities of Parliament and Provincial Legislation Act 2004 is very specific about who, in the event of persons creating a disturbance. It says that a person who creates and takes part in any disturbance, a member in fact, in the precincts while Parliament or House of Committees meeting may be arrested and removed from the precincts on the order of the Speaker or the Chairperson or a person designated by the Speaker or Chairperson by a staff member or a member of the security services. We thought that we should indicate this because often the nature of what happens in the moment, the each of the persons with various responsibility have to act promptly. But there's also a question that we do wish to stress about the internal management of Parliament, that the institution operates on the assumption that we agree, and in fact we all, 400 of us in the National Assembly, stood there and or took an oath and or affirmed that we'll obey both the Constitution and all other law. And this all other law, in my interpretation, includes the rules that a Parliament is empowered to bring about to manage its own affairs. And when we have those in place, and they are done by agreement, in other words, there's a proportion here of how many people participate in what committees by agreement, and once that is established, the assumption is that by democratic process of those structures sitting to make decisions, once those are taken, those are going to be followed. So when people choose not to follow the rules, this is an attack on a on democratic practice. This is an attack on an appropriate manner of dealing with conflict and difference, as the speaker referred to earlier on. It resorts to methods that we may use outside of Parliament, perhaps working on different rules that plays in the streets or anywhere else. But generally speaking, in places such as ours, we are bound by the Constitution to operate democratically. And where there are differences, people have recourse to follow. And if they're unhappy with that, there are still processes that enable them to challenge and to seek a remedial action against the decisions that they may not be happy with. So it is absolutely crucial for the presiding officers in their decisions, which they make all the time, to be mindful that there are these processes available. The reason why we also have structures such as the committee that looks at powers and privileges and so on is precisely to enable members to have a fair hearing, to be able to brought to your attention that perhaps constitute a violation, and so that if they have an explanation to make, they must be able to make it there. That committee must make a decision one way or another, so that nothing happens by arbitrary means. It is arbitrary when people then use these other methods that are not agreed upon and so on. This is why, in the wisdom of the members of this parliament who created this piece of legislation, felt it appropriate that we must have it in place, because there may be a conflict, there may be a difference of opinion, there may be violations as well. And when those violations happen, the process is in place to deal with those violations. And these are the elements that are in place that enable us to do that. We simply wish to adhere to and follow democratic methods of conflict resolution in Parliament. If we abandon that, then we're in big trouble, even in more big trouble, because then we resort to fisticuffs and so on. That's not acceptable at all. So we really, to speak about the environment that we've been trying to ask for to be created in the House, that let's stick to a democratic way of handling our differences. If the authority of the presiding officers is challenged in an unreasonable manner, it becomes problematic for the House to conduct its affairs. I just thought that that's a crucial point for me to raise.
Thank you very much. We'll take the next round. We'll start with Yan, Marianne Merton. We'll just take four, Andesue, and the lady at the back, and let's take you, sir. Paula, you'll be part of the next round. Okay. All right, thanks. Yan.
Thank you, Mr. Jacobs. Presiding officers, for the few of us who were actually here last night when it went down, some of these versions are quite surprising, but I think we'll probably flesh them out over the weekend. The definition of madness surely must be to do the same thing in the same way and expect a different result. And what one is seeing from many sides, but perhaps also this morning, is pontification, self-justification, that sort of thing. What one misses is self-reflection. Given for to start off with, the point that the IFP yesterday afternoon, about 40 minutes into the sitting, had to make a proposal which the chief whip of the majority party accepted for the speaker to change a ruling. And given everything that's happened since, given the run-up to this, which was months, would you, Mr. Tsinodi, Mrs. Mbete, Mr. Frolic, have done anything differently? Upon reflection, could you have done anything better?
Thank you. Mary Ann?
Hi, Marianne Merton, Independent Newspapers. Just a very, very quick one. It's a clarification. After the head of Parliamentary Protection Services called in Protection Services and various components of the SAPS, at what stage was the presiding officer informed that police had been called in? And in compliance with the law that the Deputy Speaker has referred to. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andiswe.
Andiswe Makinana from the Million Guardian. I'm partly covered. But I would like to know from the presiding officers on how they apply the rules. Yesterday, during yesterday's sittings, we had two MPs that were instructed to withdraw their comments or leave the house. Both refused. One of them was allowed to remain in the house for the rest of the sitting. One of them was dragged out of the house by the police. Can you tell us how do you apply the rules that you're talking about? Do we also know how is Ms. Mashabela this morning? Thank you.
Marina Lamprecht from Bild newspaper. To the speaker, last night there was a request from opposition parties that you resign because you apparently have a conflict of interest being chair of the ANC as well. Is that a request you are considering?
Okay, that gives us four. Yes, here's the fifth question.
Good morning, Craig Dodds from Independent Newspapers. The thing that seemed to get the whole session off to a fairly rowdy start was the attempt to limit the time for notices of motion and so forth. Shouldn't that have been negotiated rather than relying on a rule that didn't appear to apply in the end? And were you aware before the session began that the opposition intended to filibuster? Thanks.
Thanks, Craig. That was the final question in the second round.
Thank you, Honourable Speaker. Just to respond to the question of Yan Yan, what is quite evident is that we need to tighten up the process amongst the chief whips of the different parties as far as consultation is concerned around the parliamentary program. And the matters that are brought to the National Assembly Programming Committee should be the culmination of a process. Not a process to start in the National Assembly Programming Committee that then drags out during the day and in the afternoon it creates the type of problems that we had yesterday. So that is a matter that we discussed and that we will provide the necessary support also to the programming work to ensure that when a program comes here on a Thursday morning, the proper consultations have taken place. The program of Parliament cannot be a moving target, because political parties must be informed so that they can prepare for the program for the day. So that is definitely one of the matters, Yan Yan, that require further attention. As far as the application of the rules is concerned, from my perspective, the rules must be applied as it is there. And if we deviate from the rules, then you run the serious risk that you will become a parliament where rules doesn't apply anymore. And that is something that we will continue to do, is to consistently apply the rules as they are. If certain political parties have strong opinions about certain rules being changed, then that must be done in the proper forum. There is a subcommittee on the review of rules that must complete their work, and those issues must be taken there. Then just, Honorable Speaker, if I may, in terms of the question that came in terms of the time limitation possibly on motions without notice, there was no indication in the programming committee. As the rules currently stand, there is no time limit. But there was always reasonableness to allow for that flexibility, to allow political parties to make and submit the motions that they want to submit, essentially for further debate in the House. Now, what we saw yesterday afternoon was most of those motions that were raised will never be debated in the House due to the content of those motions. And that is where unnecessary time, according to my opinion, has indeed been wasted. Another matter that we must attend to is the issue of motions without notice. A motion without notice is intended to be of national and international importance. It is not an opportunity just to make another statement. As the rule is currently applied, any member of parliament can get up, move unconstitutional motions, asking for the removal of certain people that require substantive motions, even insult certain members, South African citizens, leaders in government, and then at the end the other party must wait until everything is completed and say we disagree, we're not supporting it. Surely we need to tighten up on that as well, so that we can create greater certainty as far as all these measures are concerned.
Couldn't we have done differently? Of course, there is always room for improvement. One of the points that I would like to make is that this is a political institution. And what happens in the processing of things, like the structure the speaker referred to of the Chief Whip's Forum, things are not always smooth there. In the programming committee, which is a meeting which often is supposed to take roughly 30 minutes, just to be assured that things have been handled in the right structures, what comes to programming has been processed in the raspberry. The speaker and ourselves who chair that forum often have to tell members of the different political parties, don't bring contentious issues here. You should have sorted them out elsewhere. And yesterday the speaker appealed for that to happen. It only happened under pressure of the environment late in the evening. This is why what ended up finally was the postponement of those BRR reports, as anticipated, because she had in her wisdom, and we said with in that program that unless this is agreed, there's also a problem of, I don't know to call it inexperience or what it is. Once you talk about BRR reports, it automatically means these are all the reports that ought to be, there are 38 of them. They can be programmed for 4 days, for 3 days, for whatever number of days and so on. So once members in the Chief Whip's Forum do not agree on the nature and method of doing that, there's a problem. And so it is brought to the programming committee where we are supposed to be finalizing things and that to debate about that. And so what the presiding officers do frequently is to appeal to political parties to act appropriately and in time, every time, so that programming is not hampered by political contestation. Those things must happen in the Chief Whip Forum where those debates must take place. Most of us were in the House when the police entered the place. We were in the House as presiding officers. In fact, the speaker walked in a little later on. We sat in there. Now, the point about and members, some of the members came to find out who called the police and so on, when they were already in the House and so on. So the presiding officers were in the House already. So we saw what happened there. Of course, not outside, but also in some of the, in the corner where the member was taken out of the place, members were all over that place and we couldn't tell the details of what was happening there. The point I'm making is that we were in the house when the police entered. We must get full reports this morning, and at some stage we are going to be finding out as much detail as possible so that we determine what precisely happened in the scuffles that would have happened at that space.
Yes, ma'am.
When a member is asked to leave the house and the police are asked to, in this instance where the police were called to go, they are escorted out of the precincts of Parliament immediately, and they are not allowed back in on the day on which they asked to do that. So how Mrs. Mashabela is doing, I don't understand what it assumes. Unless the questioner has something that I do not know about. How is Ms. Mashabela doing? I don't understand it.
I'm sorry, I asked because she was dragged out. It's not like they walked her out. It was a scuffle where a number of MPs were also injured. Hence, I'm asking, how is she doing?
Okay. We are not aware whether she was she was herself hurt at all. We are not aware of that. All so far that we understand that scuffle, the details of those scuffle is what I'm saying we will get to hear about it here. We haven't had anything untoward as far as we are concerned.
Maybe just to add to that, so I think the question also was the member being dragged out, and as the deputy speaker mentioned, that a detailed report would be made available on what had happened. To our knowledge, there was no member being dragged out. In fact, that there are the instances in that process where police officers have been assaulted. The point that I want to make as to the question as to what happens when, how is a member removed, the sergeant at arms who called on the police protection unit to assist her points at the member who should be removed from the house. Protection services do not move in and randomly remove people from the house. The person is identified and pointed at, and on that basis they follow in what is expected of them. So I think that I would agree just with the point made by Deputy Speaker that the full report would be and should be made available. And of course there are different interpretations, but we only act on what we know and what we see, and also as per our mandate. Thanks, Chairperson.
Thank you, ma'am. Just on the issue of the member who was asked to withdraw from the House, of course the rules indicate that when a member is asked to withdraw, they are supposed to withdraw. And in the event that they don't withdraw from the House, the rules empower Speaker to attend to the matter. Speaker, I'm sure, would be dealing with the matter.
I remember that question. There's a question about there were two members who were asked and so on. I was also challenged on some other member as well. And one of the things we said was that because of the repeated offenses in front of the presiding officer and so on, that we take a view that some of the rulings are not immediately effected. Some of the rulings are made subsequently. And one of the things that, particularly yesterday, we ensured that we do not want we want to keep the house for as long as possible without disruption. Because any actions, any rulings that we made have a potential disruptive effect on the proceedings of the house. It does not mean if anybody was not on the day, action was not taken out of them, they are necessarily free of penalties according to the rules as they require. So those will be applied as and when the situation is appropriate. We have the responsibility to be sensitive to the environment that we ourselves, in the decisions we make, create in the House. We cannot act in a manner that is insensitive to the reality that whatever we feel, however we want to do, as much as we want to do, but we must be cognizant of the fact that our actions might themselves add to further disruption. We do not want to do things that way. So at some stage, certain decisions will be acted at different times and so on. So nobody who violates the rules in the House will go unpunished, according to the rules, of course.
Just to illustrate that last point made by the Deputy Speaker, I had a ruling, in fact, I still have a ruling to make based on yesterday's events. Even after advice, I did not make that ruling because one of the things that I've decided from as early as possible when I started to be a presiding officer is that I don't make rulings in the middle of debates. Because if you make a ruling, then it diverts the attention of the mind, the House, and the actual business at hand at the point at which you make that ruling. For instance, I had to leave the chair to allow another presiding officer to come. So the issue was, do I first make that ruling somewhere in the middle of the debate? And I said, no, there will be more sittings next week. So that ruling, in my view, has been deferred to that. It's not that the member was left and there will be no ruling, there will be no actions. That was not going to be conducive to the rest of the business being going on in a smooth environment. So I decided to come back to the House. And when I walked in, I found that there was a cluster of people around the podium, I think basically persuading the honorable member to leave the podium. I took my seat, and then when I looked, the police were walking in. So that's when I saw, but I was not surprised. I mean, I mustn't say there was anything surprising about that because clearly the situation had been unfolding slowly but surely towards a difficult a moment. Question of the much talked about a conflict of interest because I'm the national chair of the ANC. The first time I became the national chair of South of the ANC is back after the Pulukwane conference of the ANC. So that issue came up, but it had already actually happened. It was not the first time South Africa saw a national chair, specifically being a presiding officer. Honorable Likota actually told the world the other day that yes, he was chair of the NCOP and he was national chairperson, and there was no issue. Secondly, in general, all of us honorable members belong to political parties. That you then have been deployed in your party as this, that, and the other is a detail. We are all members of political parties. That's how we end up in parliament, sent by the political parties we belong to. So I don't think we should confuse ourselves about this thing about conflict of interest. Does Honorable Zille, as Premier of the Western Cape, have a conflict of interest? You know, I think when we want to take up issues and to engage on them, to arrive at a particular point, maybe as we grow as our own democracy in South Africa, we should do that. Put issues, let them be engaged with, but not just try and target one person and try to create an issue which in fact can't stand scrutiny. when it comes to the fact that all honorable members are members of political parties. I think I've exhausted what I would like to comment on.
I just want to suggest that this question about the speaker, Honorable Frini, was confronted with the same question, and there was a robust debate about it. I would like to ask Luzuko Jacobs to make available that debate to give it to you, because I think many of the answers that the speaker may not have given here exist, are there in that debate, and were expressed very sharply by herself and so on. But I thought that also one of the things that I do know, the speaker and the chair of the NCOP as the executive authority, like they have been doing, consulting with the heads of political parties. As I recall, that's one area where some of these things will be discussed. The Chief Whip's Forum is one forum where the problems of members in the House and the conduct in the House and the management of the House gets discussed there, but also often now and then with the heads of political parties. So in the meetings that will emerge, I know that the Speaker has put this on her notes for dealing with those issues there, in order to address, at least at the senior level of those who lead us in the House and generally political parties, to address the concerns that we have about the manner in which members in the House are conducting themselves, generally speaking. So that's an area, if there's an area that we hope can produce some results, if any, but this is one of the areas where we have to confront it there. This is a political institution. Some of the robustness often goes out of bounds. It becomes more than overzealousness, becomes something else. So the appeal will be to try and have them contain it within the grounds of robustness, but not go out of bounds.
Thank you. I think we have generously made up for the lost time at the beginning. We'll take the final round of questions. So I've noted the hands that are up. Janet, we'll start with you, and then we follow the order: Sunday Times, Mail and Guardian, ETV, and then the SABC. Okay, there's one hand at the end. I cannot really see, but we'll take you as the last question, ma'am. So, Janet, shall we start with the final round of questions?
Just on a point of clarity, because I mean we've obviously got to compile the facts here, and it's I'm still feeling uneasy about the decisions. Can you just answer? Give us clarity on the poly, on the feed, the TV feed. How did that decision get taken to cut the feed? I don't feel that I've got the answer there. And also with regard, can you just give for absolute clarity that it was the sergeant at arms who actually called the presiding officers, who called, and the police ended up coming in. That was a very unusual move, and it seems that the speaker was not aware. Can you just give us 100% clarity on that, on those orders? Thanks.
Mine is a follow-up on that. Does the sergeant-at-arms have the authority to call in the police? Because during the EFF hearing, she said she didn't have that authority.
Speaker, I think in your response to the question, I'm following up on what Janet has just said, you sort of maybe admitted to censorship because you spoke about how you have to balance and make sure that you protect the image of Parliament. Can you please tell us how is the public's right to know what is happening in Parliament less important than this protection of the image of Parliament? And can I just sneak in one other question to Zelda? Can she tell us how many police were assaulted and who assaulted them? Thanks.
And this way, can I just ask you to repeat the last question to Zelda?
The police that were assaulted, how many were assaulted and who assaulted the police?
Thanks. Paula?
My questions are also to the head of security, Zelda. I just have a few things I'd like to clarify. Firstly, you made the impression that the police that were there yesterday were the ordinary police of Parliament who are here doing their day-to-day business. But I really got a sense, well, actually, in fact, I saw and photographed several police vans
before the debate had even started, parked outside of Parliament, with police getting into full riot gear or public order, potato, potato, whatever, however you want to call it, getting into full gear and then going into the precinct. Now, were there reinforcements called before the debate had even began? And then secondly, again, on the concerns that police were assaulted, I've had several MPs, and I've spoken to them on record, one is in a sling, one has a cut lip, one was an elderly woman in her 60s who was apparently pushed to the ground, and the EFF MP, according to the EFF, had to go to hospital. So, I mean, is this appropriate action? Is it not too heavy-handed? And from seeing the riot police arrive, or public order police arrive early, before the debate had begun, surely this heavy-handed approach was planned for.
Thank you very much. It's Lukanyo once again from SABC. Just two things. A question mostly directed at the speaker. The first one being, ma'am, are you disappointed by yesterday's actions and how things played out in general? And also, aren't you a little bit concerned because you said that Parliament isn't yet 6 months old, and already we've got, you know, we've had a couple of really interesting days for us as the media in Parliament, and because of what's happening in the National Assembly. So aren't you a little bit concerned over where we'll find ourselves 2 years into the life of this Parliament, where we'll find ourselves 3 years into the life of this Parliament if the first 5 months look like this? What are we going to look like 3 years down the line? Are we even going to have a parliament 3 years down the line? Thanks, ma'am.
There was a final question right at the back. I cannot see now. Yes.
Alice Dean from Media 24. I just wanted to know, because some MPs are saying they fear actually coming to work. And the EFF released a statement saying that it seems like they have to start developing mechanisms to defend themselves in the House. Are you concerned about that possible backlash? Thanks.
Thank you very much. That is it from the question side.
The members who, let me also just pose this way. When members in the House make it impossible for the House to conduct its work, they do not only frustrate the presiding officers and their ability to do their work, they also frustrate the rest of the other members who are keen to see the business of the House proceeding without disruption. They create an environment which is not healthy all around for those who would like to see the business of the House being conducted appropriately. There are consequences when people do not act according to the rules, which are contained in the rules, which the induction that members receive when they enter Parliament, they are exposed to be aware of. So when the steps are taken to tell members, because you are violating the rule, you leave the House. And members continue to do that. Members are creating an environment in which it becomes impossible for the presiding officers, but also for others who would like to engage in a debate and in the substance of the issues that are on the table, rather than in the drama of preventing others from talking or raising issues or allowing themselves to come into play. There's no need for anybody to want to get protection as far as we are concerned. Because part of the reason why we appeal to members to choose a democratic process of resolving their conflicts is because we want to avoid them using fists and other things to settle their differences. Like the advert that talks about no lawyers, no lawyers. And people resolve issues with swords and fists, and the winner got the whiskey or something like that. We can't degenerate into that method of resolving conflicts. And this is why we say that if members do not do that, there will be no need for anybody to fear or be afraid of anything happening to them and so on. It is only if you know that you don't intend to, like at a traffic, the former deputy president of the country used to tell us, even if you know you are right and the robot is green, do watch left and right, because otherwise someone might run you over because they're on the cell phone or their car brakes have gone wrong. So you must be cautious, obey the rules, even when you know you are in the right yourself. So this is why it is correct to follow when you feel aggrieved by the processes in the house. There's a recourse. Follow the recourse. Do not jump onto the table and demand answers on the spot. And then expect to be told, please, dear, just jump to the left and not to the right. You can't. It's incorrect. It's wrong. We expect members to behave appropriately, conduct themselves appropriately, and then they will not provoke in the house conflicts that we don't want to see. The police will not be have to enter into issues that they are not meant to be doing for and so on, except where there's a requirement for them to protect, and which is their mandate, that they would then do that. So I really think that this matter of people creating the impression of them wanting to go and protect themselves is absolutely politically wrong and out of order. Not only because when people do that, some of these things are done for other reasons as well. Members were in the gallery, and some of them were literally openly screaming, beat them up if they come in, beat them up in the gallery, a guest to parliament screaming that stuff. I mean, you can't have people doing that. Coming into here as our guests, and I suspect one of them is actually a member, screaming that kind of language. You can't have people saying that kind of things. And when there are consequences, when the protection services acts against them, then they plead innocence. It's, no. Let's dissuade members. Let's not give credence to incorrect perceptions created that people are victims, when in fact they're provoking an environment in the house that is problematic. That invites members of the house in their entirety are frustrated. They all act in certain ways, in ways that are out of the bounds of reasonableness in the house because of the frustrations that we are seeing here. And that's what we are trying to prevent. And so I just wanted to suggest that, no, we must be careful in painting a picture of what is called heavy-handedness, because of the accounts that happened yesterday. We must get reports, and we must do that as swiftly as possible, Zelda. I think it is appropriate that we must move with speed, produce the information that will come out of what happened in that scuffle, so that we members of the media here get a correct information. And when you say you've interviewed members on the record and so on, I hope you've gone across the board. You must interview members across the board, including the police and others and so on, so that you have a fair representation of what emerged here. Yes, let me leave it there.
There's a question that says, aren't you worried there'll be a backlash? Well, the choice of the word backlash to me immediately raises the issue of when you coin that statement, is it because you are apportioning an understanding of provocation, backlash? You are obviously apportioning blame on the institution, on the people who work and run the institution. And I want to use that to actually say it has been a matter of concern to us that the media has been quite ready to elaborately put out messages, create a picture that's based on a one-sided understanding of events without actually, most definitely not to us as the people who would have been involved directly, but already apportioning a particular, you know, skewed understanding of where things start or how it is that the situation ends up at where it would be. So I must just say, for us, it's a matter of concern. We want to believe that the media has a responsibility to inform, and that in order to be put in a position to inform in a balanced fashion, views from all angles have to be entertained. In fact, in my view, the media ought to actually go all out to make sure that they have a balanced understanding of what's going on. Because you cannot apportion 100% blame one side or another if you are going to try and paint a picture that you yourself have not been intricately or internally involved in the developments of. So I'm simply also using the opportunity to communicate to members of the media that for us it's a matter of concern. We don't think that there's a lot of energy that gets put into making sure that members of the media have an all-round case, so that you don't comment or find yourself in the difficult space of just looking at things from one perspective. Then we believe you are giving the people half the story. We in politics are used to, you know, developments. Every day there's something new, a new drama, new whatever. That's what happens. So we will go to our meetings, we will get information, we will analyze as thoroughly as it is humanly possible, and we will come to certain conclusions, and on that basis we'll take other steps moving into the future. By the very nature of the institution, the question about whether I was disappointed yesterday. Absolutely. We were not only disappointed, we were depressed. Because how do you come to an institution that must have at the center of it an approach of consensus building? Because this institution is not for only the members who are here. It's about the people who sent the members here. And none of those people are interested in the drama that's happening here. They are not interested in the drama. They are interested in what we're supposed to be engaging about. That's really their main focus. And therefore, we come here on the basis of an assumption that we're open-minded. We know we don't come from the same political background and ought to come here in the same way as the 1994 Parliament came here on the basis of an assumption that we must always be ready to hear the other side as much as we would hope that the other side is listening. That's how we arrived here back in 1994, because back where we had negotiated the interim constitution, we had had a consensus-building attitude and approach to things. Why is it different in the fifth parliament? I think what I told you at the beginning is what you must understand. That there were predeterminations before some of us arrived here. But being the people that are used to deploying these mechanisms of actually conflict resolution, that's what we should pin our hopes on. We cannot give up. We can't. We won't give up. We will continue to say the way to work is to talk to each other and to listen to each other and to try and find one another somewhere along the way. And for the presiding officers, we must always try to make it possible to enable honorable members to engage, to create the space to work together. Because if we don't, it can only lead us to a disaster. But we, the presiding officers, have come here to uphold the constitutional values. We have come here to uphold the dignity and the business of the House. We must enable honorable members to do their work. In fact, one of the people who spoke very, very passionately yesterday morning here was the chief whip of the DA, who said, "Madam Speaker, at least to the extent that you are my speaker, it doesn't matter who else is doing whatever. We cannot be made to be subjected under a people who represent a very small percentage of people in South Africa." But in order for us to be able to work in an orderly fashion, honorable members must be willing to also do that. They must comment in good faith. They must be truthful in what they tell the media. But we think there's a lot more skill in utilizing the chamber, the plenary, to create distorted understandings out there about, in fact, what's happening in Parliament. I think that's what I'm, as far as I'm prepared to go, but I think Zelda might have something to add on the security issues.
Thanks, Madam Chair. Just a brief comment. There were very specific questions raised as to who of the police were assaulted and by whom. I just want to say that that would be subject to investigation, so I think it's premature to make any information of that nature available. That would be contained in the report as promised, that a full report would be available. Just on the various, on the next question as to reinforcements of the police, as indicated earlier, the unit we're referring to, Parliament Protection Services Unit, is a joint command. It consists of Parliament Protection Services and the police who provide services to Parliament. So they were not called in, they were on the precinct as they have been for the last while. Also to ensure that the necessary protection is given to members, to the public who would enter here, as indicated also that we've had disturbances in the gallery, etc., so that the business of Parliament would continue. So it is a service, it's a security service to Parliament. They were not called in specifically yesterday, they were on the precinct, as they've been over the last while. As indicated, that the report is being prepared, and that would be made available to the presiding officers as to the events of yesterday from a security point of view. Thank you.
Thank you
very much. I'm sure the report will also answer specific questions about who took what decision for the switching off of the feed, et cetera, et cetera. So all those matters fall into the category of matters under consideration that the presiding officers are following up on. Ladies and gentlemen, just before we close, Deputy Speaker.
No, I just thought that it's important for us to, on security matters, to talk about the security of members generally, and staff, including the public that comes to this place, to Parliament at all times. So the necessity for protection and presence of police is a 24/7 responsibility, and it takes different intensity at different times of the year, the sonar, and based on whatever information they have about what they think is likely to happen, what is likely to be happening in those events and so on, and whether there is any threat that they think exists anywhere for whatever reason. The global environment is dangerous. We are seeing things happening in parliaments elsewhere, such as in Canada, and it increases the responsibility to proactively prevent also any security threat that might exist as a result of people doing what others refer to as copycat conduct and behavior. So that responsibility extends to everyone in this institution, that it is the responsibility of the presiding officers and the protection services to ensure that we can at least, to the best possible manner, ensure that people are protected. They do not have to suffer the risks that might likely occur and so on. And this is why it's important that both internally, in the climate and the environment we create by our conduct and how we handle ourselves as members, is consistent with creating that environment that will ensure that there's no need for anyone to fear. And if there's any threat, it will be dealt with effectively and without any undue harm to anybody. Yes, thanks.
Thank you, Speaker, Deputy Speaker, House Chairperson, and the Secretariat. Thank you very much. Colleagues, the press conference is at hand. Thank you so much.
All those issues have limitations. And even in the Bill of Rights, those limitations are clearly pointed out, that there isn't one element from which there's an endless right or a heightened right that is more than other rights. But that Parliament is here for a purpose, and that purpose has to be protected and pursued.
Zelda, I think those are four lines. I think because there's an assumption that the powers and privileges and immunities of Parliament and Provincial Legislation Act 2004. It's very specific about who, in the event of persons creating a disturbance. It says that a person who creates and takes part in any disturbance, a member, in fact, in the precincts while Parliament or House of Committees meeting may be arrested and removed from the precincts on the order of the Speaker or the Chairperson or a person designated by the Speaker or Chairperson by a staff member or a member of the security services. We thought that we should indicate this because often the nature of what happens in the moment, each of the persons with various responsibility have to act promptly. But there's also a question that we do wish to stress about the internal management of Parliament, that the institution operates on the assumption that we agree, and in fact, we all, 400 of us in the National Assembly, stood there and or took an oath and or affirmed that we'll obey both the Constitution and all other law. And this all other law, in my interpretation, includes the rules that a Parliament is empowered to bring about to manage its own affairs. And when we have those in place, and they are done by agreement, in other words, there's a proportion here of how many people participate in what committees by agreement, and once that is established, the assumption is that by democratic process of those structures sitting to make decisions, once those are taken, those are going to be followed. So when people choose not to follow the rules, this is an attack on democratic practice. This is an attack on an appropriate manner of dealing with conflict and difference, as the speaker referred to earlier on. It resorts to methods that we may use outside of Parliament, perhaps working on different rules that plays in the streets or anywhere else. But generally speaking, in places such as ours, we are bound by the Constitution to operate democratically. And where there are differences, people have recourse to follow. And if they're unhappy with that, there are still processes that enable them to challenge and to seek a remedial action against the decisions that they may not be happy with. So it is absolutely crucial for the presiding officers in their decisions, which they make all the time, to be mindful that there are these processes available. The reason why we also have structures such as the committee that looks at powers and privileges and so on is precisely to enable members to have a fair hearing, to be able to brought things to be brought to your attention that perhaps constitute a violation, and so that if they have an explanation to make, they must be able to make it there. That committee must make a decision one way or another, so that nothing happens by arbitrary means. It is arbitrary when people then use other methods that are not agreed upon and so on. This is why, in the wisdom of the members of this parliament who created this piece of legislation, felt it appropriate that we must have it in place because there may be a conflict, there may be a difference of opinion, there may be violations as well. And when those violations happens, the process is in place to deal with those violations. And these are the elements that are in place that enable us to do that. We simply wish to adhere to and follow democratic methods of conflict resolution in Parliament. If we abandon that, then we're in big trouble, even in more big trouble, because then we resort to fisticuffs and so on. That's not acceptable at all. So we really, to speak about the environment that we've been trying to ask for to be created in the House, that let's stick to a democratic way of handling our differences. If the authority of the presiding officers is challenged in an unreasonable manner, it becomes problematic for the House to conduct its affairs. I just thought that that's a crucial point for me to raise.
Thank you very much. We'll take the next round. We'll start with Yan, Marianne Merton. We'll just take four, Andesue, and the lady at the back, and let's take you, sir. Paula, you'll be part of the next round. Okay. All right, thanks. Yan,
thank you, Mr. Jacobs. Presiding officers, for the few of us who were actually here last night when it went down, some of these versions are quite surprising, but I think we'll probably flesh them out over the weekend. The definition of madness surely must be to do the same thing in the same way and expect a different result. And what one is seeing from many sides, but perhaps also this morning, is pontification, self-justification, that sort of thing. What one misses is self-reflection. Given for, to start off with, the point that the IFP yesterday afternoon, about 40 minutes into the sitting, had to make a proposal which the chief whip of the majority party accepted for the speaker to change a ruling. And given everything that's happened since, given the run-up to this, which was months, would you, Mr. Tsunodi, Mrs. Mbete, Mr. Frolic, have done anything differently? Upon reflection, could you have done anything better?
Thank you. Mary Ann?
Hi, Marianne Merton, Independent Newspapers. Just a very, very quick one. It's a clarification. After the head of Parliamentary Protection Services called in Protection Services and various components of the SAPS, at what stage was the presiding officer informed that police had been called in? And in compliance with the law that the Deputy Speaker has referred to. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andiswa.
Andiswa Makinana from the Million Guardian. I'm partly covered. But I would like to know from the presiding officers on how they apply the rules. Yesterday, during yesterday's sittings, we had two MPs that were instructed to withdraw their comments or leave the House. Both refused. One of them was allowed to remain in the House for the rest of the sitting. One of them was dragged out of the House by the police. Can you tell us how do you apply the rules that you're talking about? Do we also know how is Ms. Mashabela this morning? Thank you.
Marina Lamprecht from Bild newspaper. To the speaker, last night there was a request from opposition parties that you resign because you apparently have a conflict of interest being chair of the ANC as well. Is that a request you are considering?
Okay, that gives us four. Yes, here's the fifth question.
Good morning, Craig Dodds from Independent Newspapers. The thing that seemed to get the whole session off to a fairly rowdy start was the attempt to limit the time for notices of motion and so forth. Shouldn't that have been negotiated rather than relying on a rule that didn't appear to apply in the end? And were you aware before the session began that the opposition intended to filibuster? Thanks.
Thanks, Craig. That was the final question in the second round.
Thank you, Honourable Speaker. Just to respond to the question of Yan Yan, what is quite evident is that we need to tighten up the process amongst the chief whips of the different parties as far as consultation is concerned around the parliamentary program. And the matters that are brought to the National Assembly Programming Committee should be the culmination of a process. Not a process to start in the National Assembly Programming Committee that then drags out during the day and in the afternoon it creates the type of problems that we had yesterday. So that is a matter that we discussed and that we will provide the necessary support also to the programming whip to ensure that when a program comes here on a Thursday morning, the proper consultations have taken place. The program of Parliament cannot be a moving target, because political parties
must be informed so that they can prepare for the program for the day. So that is definitely one of the matters, Yan-Yan, that require further attention. As far as the application of the rules is concerned, from my perspective, the rules must be applied as it is there. And if we deviate from the rules, then you run the serious risk that you will become a parliament where rules doesn't apply anymore. And that is something that we will continue to do, is to consistently apply the rules as they are. If certain political parties have strong opinions about certain rules being changed, then that must be done in the proper forum. There is a subcommittee on the review of rules that must complete their work, and those issues must be taken there. Then just, Honorable Speaker, if I may, in terms of the question that came in terms of the time limitation possibly on motions without notice, there was no indication in the programming committee. As the rules currently stand, there is no time limit. But there was always reasonableness to allow for that flexibility, to allow political parties to make and submit the motions that they want to submit, essentially for further debate in the House. Now, what we saw yesterday afternoon was most of those motions that were raised will never be debated in the House due to the content of those motions. And that is where unnecessary time, according to my opinion, has indeed been wasted. Another matter that we must attend to is the issue of motions without notice. A motion without notice is intended to be of national and international importance. It is not an opportunity just to make another statement. As the rule is currently applied, any member of parliament can get up, move unconstitutional motions, asking for the removal of certain people that require substantive motions, even insult certain members, South African citizens, leaders in government, and then at the end the other party must wait until everything is completed and say we disagree, we're not supporting it. Surely we need to tighten up on that as well, so that we can create greater certainty as far as all these measures are concerned.
Couldn't we have done differently? Of course, there is always room for improvement. One of the points that I would like to make is that this is a political institution. And what happens in the processing of things, like the structure the speaker referred to of the Chief Whip's Forum, things are not always smooth there. In the programming committee, which is a meeting which often is supposed to take roughly 30 minutes, just to be assured that things have been handled in the right structures, what comes to programming has been processed in the right way. The speaker and ourselves who chair that forum often have to tell members of the different political parties, don't bring contentious issues here. You should have sorted them out elsewhere. And yesterday, the speaker appealed for that to happen. It only happened under pressure of the environment. Yeah.
Thank you. I think we have generously made up for the lost time at the beginning. We'll take the final round of questions. So I've noted the hands that are up. Janet, we'll start with you. And then we follow the order, Sunday Times, Mail and Guardian, ETV, and then the SABC. Okay, there's one hand at the end. I cannot really see, but we'll take you as the last question, ma'am. So Janet, shall we start with the final round of questions?
Just on a point of clarity, because I mean we've obviously got to compile the facts here, and it's I'm still feeling uneasy about the decisions. Can you just answer? Give us clarity on the TV feed. How did that decision get taken to cut the feed? I don't feel that I've got the answer there. And also with regard, can you just give for absolute clarity that it was the sergeant at arms who actually called the presiding officers, who called, and the police ended up coming in. That was a very unusual move, and it seems that the speaker was not aware. Can you just give us 100% clarity on that, on those orders? Thanks.
Mine is a follow-up on that. Does the sergeant-at-arms have the authority to call in the police? Because during the EFF hearings, she said she didn't have that authority.
Speaker, I think in your response to the question, I'm following up on what Janet has just said, you sort of maybe admitted to censorship because you spoke about how you have to balance and make sure that you protect the image of Parliament. Can you please tell us how is the public's right to know what is happening in Parliament less important than this protection of the image of Parliament? And can I just sneak in one other question to Zelda? Can she tell us how many police were assaulted and who assaulted them? Thanks.
And this way, can I just ask you to repeat the last question to Zelda?
The police that were assaulted, how many were assaulted and who assaulted the police?
Thanks. Paula?
My questions are also to the head of security, Zelda. I just have a few things I'd like to clarify. Firstly, you made the impression that the police that were there yesterday were the ordinary police of Parliament who are here doing their day-to-day business. But I really got a sense, well, actually, in fact, I saw and photographed several police vans before the debate had even started, parked outside of Parliament, with police getting into full riot gear or public order, potato, potato, however you want to call it, getting into full gear and then going into the precinct. Now, were there reinforcements called before the debate had even began? And then secondly, again, on the concerns that police were assaulted, I've had several MPs, and I've spoken to them on record. One is in a sling, one has a cut lip. One was an elderly woman in her 60s who was apparently pushed to the ground. And the EFF MP, according to the EFF, had to go to hospital. So, I mean, is this appropriate action? Is it not too heavy-handed? And from seeing the riot police arrive, or public order police arrive early, before the debate had begun, surely this heavy-handed approach was planned for.
Thank you very much. It's Lukhanyo once again from SABC. Just two things. A question mostly directed at the speaker, the first one being, ma'am, are you disappointed by yesterday's actions and how things played out in general? And also, aren't you a little bit concerned because you said that Parliament isn't yet 6 months old and already we've got... You know, we've had a couple of really interesting days for us as the media in Parliament, and because of what's happening in the National Assembly, so aren't you a little bit concerned over where we'll find ourselves 2 years into the life of this Parliament, where we'll find ourselves 3 years into the life of this Parliament, if the first 5 months look like this? What are we going to look like 3 years down the line? Are we even going to have a parliament 3 years down the line? Thanks, ma'am.
There was a final question right at the back. I cannot see now. Yes.
Alice Dean from Media 24. I just wanted to know, because some MPs are saying they fear actually coming to work. And the EFF released a statement saying that it seems like they have to start developing mechanisms to defend themselves in the House. Are you concerned about that possible backlash? Thanks.
Very much. That is it from the question side.
Zelda
must get ready. There are many security questions.
The members who, let me also just pose this way. When members in the House make it impossible for the House to conduct its work, they do not only frustrate the presiding officers and their ability to do their work, they also frustrate the rest of the other members who are keen to see the business of the House proceeding without disruption. They create an environment which is not healthy all around for those who would like to see the business of the House being conducted appropriately. There are consequences when people do not act according to the rules, which are contained in the rules, which the induction that members receive when they enter parliament, they are exposed to be aware of. So when the steps are taken to tell members, because you are violating the rule, you leave the house. And members continue to do that. Members are creating an environment in which it becomes impossible for the presiding officers, but also for others who would like to engage in a debate and in the substance of the issues that are on the table rather than in the drama of preventing others from talking or raising issues or allowing themselves to come into play. There's no need for anybody to want to get protection as far as we are concerned, because part of the reason why we appeal to members to choose a democratic process of resolving their conflicts is because we want to avoid them using fists and other things to settle their differences. Like the advert that talks about no lawyers, no lawyers. And people resolve issues with swords and fists, and the winner got the whiskey or something like that. We can't degenerate into that method of resolving conflicts. And this is why we say that if members do not do that, there will be no need for anybody to fear or be afraid of anything happening to them and so on. It is only if you know that you don't intend to, like at a traffic, the former deputy president of the country used to tell us, even if you know you are right and the robot is green, do watch left and right, because otherwise someone might run you over because they're on the cell phone or their car brakes have gone wrong. So you must be cautious, obey the rules, even when you know you are in the right yourself. So this is why it is correct to follow when you feel aggrieved by the processes in the house. There's a recourse. Follow the recourse. Do not jump onto the table and demand answers on the spot. And then expect to be told, please, dear, just jump to the left and not to the right. You can't. It's incorrect. It's wrong. We expect members to behave appropriately, conduct themselves appropriately, and then they will not provoke in the house conflicts that we don't want to see. The police will not be have to enter into issues that they are not meant to be doing for and so on, except where there's a requirement for them to protect, and which is their mandate, that they would then do that. So I really think that this matter of people creating the impression of them wanting to go and protect themselves is absolutely politically wrong and out of order. Not only because when people do that, some of these things are done for other reasons as well. Members were in the gallery, and some of them were literally openly screaming, beat them up if they come in, beat them up in the gallery, a guest to parliament screaming that stuff. I mean, you can't have people doing that. Coming into here as our guests, and I suspect one of them is actually a member, screaming that kind of language. You can't have people saying that kind of things. And when there are consequences, when the protection services acts against them, then they plead innocence. It's, no. Let's dissuade members. Let's not give credence to incorrect perceptions created that people are victims, when in fact they are provoking an environment in the house that is problematic. That invites members of the house in their entirety are frustrated. They all act in certain ways, in ways that are out of the bounds of reasonableness in the house, because of the frustrations that we are seeing here. And that's what we are trying to prevent. And so I just wanted to suggest that, no, we must be careful in painting a picture of what is called heavy-handedness because of the accounts that happened yesterday. We must get reports, and we must do that as swiftly as possible, Zelda. I think it is appropriate that we must move with speed, produce the information that will come out of what happened in that scuffle, so that we members of the media here get a correct information. And when you say you've interviewed members on the record and so on, you must. I hope you've gone across the board. You must interview members across the board, including the police and others and so on, so that you have a fair representation of what emerged here. Yes, let me leave it there.
There's a question that says, aren't you worried there'll be a backlash? Well, the choice of the word backlash to me immediately raises the issue of when you coin that statement, is it because you are apportioning an understanding of provocation, backlash? You are obviously apportioning blame on the institution, on the people who work and run the institution. And I want to use that to actually say it has been a matter of concern to us that the media has been quite ready to elaborately put out messages, create a picture that's based on a one-sided understanding of events without actually, most definitely not to us as the people who would have been involved directly, but already apportioning a particular, you know, skewed understanding of where things start or how it is that the situation ends up at where it would be. So I must just say, for us, it's a matter of concern. We want to believe that the media has a responsibility to inform, and that in order to be put in a position to inform in a balanced fashion, views from all angles have to be entertained.
Late in the evening, this is why what ended up finally was the postponement of those BRR reports, as anticipated, because she had in her wisdom, and we said with in that programming that unless this is agreed, there's also problem of, I don't know to call it inexperience or what it is. Once you talk about BRR reports, it automatically means these are all the reports that ought to be, there are 38 of them, they can be programmed for 4 days, for 3 days, for whatever number of days and so on. So once members in the Chief Whip's Forum do not agree on the nature and method of doing that, there's a problem. And so it is brought to the programming committee where we are supposed to be finalizing things, and that to debate about that. And so what the presiding officers do frequently is to appeal to political parties to act appropriately and in time every time, so that programming is not hampered by political contestation. Those things must happen in the Chief Whip Forum where those debates must take place. Most of us were in the house when the police entered the place. We were in the house as presiding officers. In fact, the speaker walked in a little later on. We sat in there. Now, the point about and members, some of the members came to find out who called the police and so on, when they were already in the house and so on. So the presiding officers were in the house already. So we saw what happened there. Of course, not outside, but also in some of the in the corner where the member was taken out of the place. Members were all over that place, and we couldn't tell the details of what was happening there. The point I'm making is that we were in the house when the police entered. We must get full reports this morning, and at some stage we are going to be finding out as much detail as possible so that we determine what precisely happened in the scuffles that would have happened at that space.
Yes, ma'am.
When a member is asked to leave the house and the police are asked to, in this instance where the police were called to go, they are escorted out of the precincts of Parliament immediately, and they are not allowed back in on the day on which they asked to do that. So how Mrs. Mashabela is doing, I don't understand what it assumes. Unless the questioner has something that I do not know about. How is Ms. Mashabela doing? I don't understand it.
I'm sorry, I asked because she was dragged out. It's not like they walked her out. It was a scuffle where a number of MPs were also injured. Hence, I'm asking, how is she doing?
Okay. We are not aware whether she was in, she was herself hurt at all. We are not aware of that. All so far that we understand that scuffle, the details of those scuffle is what I'm saying we will get to hear about it here. We haven't had anything untoward as far as we are concerned.
Maybe just to add to that, so I think the question also was the member being dragged out, and as the deputy speaker mentioned, that a detailed report would be made available on what had happened. To our knowledge, there was no member being dragged out. In fact, that there are the instances in that process where police officers have been assaulted. The point that I want to make as to the question as to what happens when, how is a member removed? The sergeant at arms who called on the police protection unit to assist her points at the member who should be removed from the house. Protection services do not move in and randomly remove people from the house. The person is identified and pointed at, and on that basis, they follow in what is expected of them. So I think that I would agree just with the point made by Deputy Speaker that the full report would be and should be made available. And of course, there are different interpretations, but we only act on what we know and what we see, and also as per our mandate. Thanks, Chairperson.
Thank you, ma'am. Just on the issue of the member who was asked to withdraw from the House, of course, the rules indicate that when a member is asked to withdraw, they are supposed to withdraw. And in the event that they don't withdraw from the House, the rules empower Speaker to attend to the matter. So Speaker, I'm sure, would be dealing with the matter.
I remember that question. There's a question about there were two members who were asked and so on. I was also challenged on some other member as well. And one of the things we said was that because of the repeated offenses in front of the presiding officer and so on, that we take a view that some of the rulings are not immediately effected. Some of the rulings are made subsequently. And one of the things that, particularly yesterday, we ensured that we do not want we want to keep the house for as long as possible without disruption. Because any actions, any rulings that we made have a potential disruptive effect on the proceedings of the house. It does not mean if anybody was not on the day action was not taken out of them, they are necessarily free of penalties according to the rules as they require. So those will be applied as and when the situation is appropriate. We have the responsibility to be sensitive to the environment that we ourselves, in the decisions we make, create in the House. We cannot act in a manner that is insensitive to the reality that whatever we feel, however we want to do, as much as we want to do, but we must be cognizant of the fact that our actions might themselves add to further disruption. We do not want to do things that way. So at some stage, certain decisions will be acted at different times and so on. So nobody who violates the rules in the House will go unpunished, according to the rules, of course.
Just to illustrate that last point made by the Deputy Speaker, I had a ruling, in fact, I still have a ruling to make based on yesterday's events. Even after advice, I did not make that ruling because one of the things that I've decided from as early as possible when I started to be a presiding officer is that I don't make rulings in the middle of debates. Because if you make a ruling, then it diverts the attention of the mind, the House, and the actual business at hand at the point at which you make that ruling. For instance, I had to leave the chair to allow another presiding officer to come. So the issue was, do I first make that ruling somewhere in the middle of the debate? And I said, no, there will be more sittings next week. So that ruling, in my view, has been deferred to that. It's not that the member was left and there will be no ruling, there will be no actions. That was not going to be conducive to the rest of the business being going on in a smooth environment. So I decided to come back to the House. And when I walked in, I found that there was a cluster of people around the podium, I think basically persuading the honorable member to leave the podium. I took my seat, and then when I looked, the police were walking in. So that's when I saw, but I was not surprised. I mean, I mustn't say there was anything surprising about that because clearly the situation had been unfolding slowly but surely towards a difficult a moment. Question of the much talked about a conflict of interest because I'm the national chair of the ANC. The first time I became the national chair of the ANC is back after the Polokwane conference of the ANC. So that issue came up, but it had already actually happened. It was not the first time South Africa saw a national chair, specifically being a presiding officer. Honorable Likota actually told the world the other day that yes, he was chair of the NCOP and he was national chairperson, and there was no issue. Secondly, in general, all of us honorable members belong to political parties. That you then have been deployed in your party as this, that, and the other is a detail. We are all members of political parties. That's how we end up in parliament, sent by the political parties we belong to. So I don't think we should confuse ourselves about this thing about conflict of interest. Does Honorable Zille, as Premier of the Western Cape, have a conflict of interest? You know, I think when we want to take up issues and to engage on them, to arrive at a particular point, maybe as we grow as our own democracy in South Africa, we should do that. Put issues, let them be engaged with, but not just try and target one person and try to create an issue which in fact can't stand scrutiny when it comes to the fact that all honorable members are members of political parties. I think I've exhausted what I would like to comment on.
I just want to suggest that this question about the speaker, Honorable Frini, was confronted with the same question, and there was a robust debate about it. I would like to ask Luzuko Jacobs to make available that debate to give it to you, because I think many of the answers that the speaker may not have given here exist, are there in that debate, and were expressed very sharply by herself and so on. But I thought that also one of the things that I do know, the speaker and the chair of the NCOP as the executive authority, like they have been doing consulting with the heads of political parties. As I recall, that's one area where some of these things will be discussed. The Chief Whip's Forum is one forum where the problems of members in the House and the conduct in the House and the management of the House gets discussed there, but also often now and then with the heads of political parties. So in the meetings that will emerge, I know that the speaker has put this on her notes for dealing with those issues there, in order to address, at least at the senior level of those who lead us in the House and generally political parties, to address the concerns that we have about the manner in which members in the House are conducting themselves, generally speaking. So that's an area, if there's an area that we hope can produce some results, if any, but this is one of the areas where we have to confront it there. This is a political institution. Some of the robustness often goes out of bounds. It becomes more than overzealousness, becomes something else. So the appeal will be to try and have them contain it within the grounds of robustness, but not go out of bounds.
The frustration of trying to manage a situation where people are going all out and they are saying it, that they are not here to cooperate. And of course, we are bound by a way of doing things that we've always followed. And we go all out to make sure we accommodate every honorable member. We make sure that they have the opportunity. Even many times yesterday, you saw honorable members getting up and for more than 3 hours, honorable members were filibustering. They were wasting as much time as possible in that first part of the program of the House. And so we have no illusion whatsoever. Even when we reached the point which we had resisted for a long time in these 5 months that we have gone through, what the law actually allows us finally happened yesterday. Because yesterday was a culmination of a long time of, you know, appealing to honorable members, trying to show them that it's okay to differ, but there are ways according to the rules that you can express the difference that you need or you want to express. And it was so obvious when the honorable member was standing at the podium. She even put her arms on the podium, making it very clear that she wants to instigate, she wants to provoke something, which is in keeping with what had been publicly declared. So I thought I should just give you that background around those 2 points, and then I think I should hand over to Luzuko. I'm sure there'll be some questions, and then we will, the three of us, and whoever else has information that might be in a better position to clarify things to you, in particular the secretariat. There's a Madam Acting Secretary, and the House Secretaries. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Honorable Speaker. The Speaker has given us direction about what to follow, which is an opportunity to members of the media to ask questions for clarification in relation to the issues that the Speaker has addressed. So we'll take a round of questions, which the presiding officers will note, and as Speaker has indicated, the presiding officers will assist each other, assisted by the Secretariat also to answer those questions. So we'll take five questions at a go. We've got four hands up. Mr. Chalata, you first. Paula, in that order. Yes. So can you just please identify yourself and the media house that you represent and ask your question, please?
All right. Thank you very much. Good morning, ma'am. My name is Lukanyo Chalata. I work for SABC. On the 21st of August, when we saw the disruption that happened, you had then referred certain members to be charged by the Powers and Privileges Committee. Is there a likelihood that you are going to take the same action again based on yesterday's events? Is that something that you're considering? Thanks very much.
Thanks, Mr. Chalata, for sticking to one question. Can we just emulate Mr. Chalata in that respect? One question per person at a time, please. Paula?
Okay, well then I'll start with Paula Charles, ENCA. I'll start with the fact that as the incident happened where MPs were forcibly removed and police were brought into the chamber, the parliamentary feed, so that sound and audio, was cut. Who makes that call? And why was that call made? And is that not censorship?
Good morning, Bianca Capozorio from the Sunday Times. I would just like to know who was the person who made the call for the riot police to come in, and following on from that, whether that level of force was necessary for one person.
Yes.
Following on, it's Janet Hurd, Media 24 newspapers. Following on that, can you explain whoever made this decision? I understand it's the Speaker who has to make that decision. Can you explain on what grounds, if so, it was made?
Okay, thank you very much. We have the first batch of questions, and we'll now afford the presiding officers an opportunity to take some of the questions and for the Secretariat to assist with the relevant questions.
I'm not sure I heard all the questions. Okay, let me start with whether we will take action and how on the 21st we had referred the matter to Powers and Privileges. At this point, as you will appreciate, we have not had those discussions, as the institution from different, we are now meeting here before you just so we can give you an understanding or give you a context, but we're still actually going to go and sit and analyze in depth, from different angles, from the point of view of people who work in this institution and what from where they were, they saw what happened. And we will analyze together, and then we can determine a course of action. The issue of who decided on the police, it's actually a detail, but I'll leave the head of security to deal with that. But I want to say the following. I said earlier on when I was addressing you that all along, we have resisted in spite of us having a law that gives us the authority indeed to call the police. Like they are also called into a court to remove anyone who's disruptive. We could not sit here in this institution and forever allow disruptions and outrageous conduct of honorable members who have come here not to work as we all do, but to come here and just push the boundaries in the process to rubbish this institution of the people. So I want to make that very clear. When the police were called, it is precisely because it's not that we were not aware that the law allows us to do that. It's not that we were not aware, but we resisted it. We did not want to go to that length because it had never happened. We had never had reason to call the police. So I think it must be understood that it is incident after incident. It is how the people that have to play certain roles apply their minds after each incident and look at those measures and mechanisms that are there at their disposal to protect the dignity of Parliament, to protect the work, the business of the House being protected, so we continue. From the first, no, it wasn't the first, it was the second in August. If there was something that we were all preoccupied with is, please can these honorable members be assisted to leave the House so we can continue with the business of the House. That's what is paramount in our minds. And there's no way we're going to allow ourselves to come here and each time just be disrupted. And as if this place is to just come and have a lot of drama. But I think, Zelda, you might want to come in on this one.
Thanks, Madam Speaker. Just briefly on the question as to who called the question was the riot police. I just want to correct the issue there. The Parliament, the presiding officers, and the committees are supported by Parliament Protection Services and the police. You would notice that we always have a police presence on the precinct. So the police wouldn't be called in specifically. The police are present on the precinct. And they perform functions as prescribed in the Act and in terms of their mandate. Yesterday, the Sergeant at Arms was called on by the House Chairperson to remove the member who was not following an order to leave the House. The Sergeant at Arms appealed to the member to leave the House. Failing that, on several occasions when that negotiations or diplomatic engagement failed to yield the result, the Sergeant at Arms stepped out and called on the services, on the assistance of the protection services. Now, let me just explain what that protection services entail. It entails Parliament Protection Services and the South African Police. In the South African Police component, there are different units supporting Parliament Protection Services. That's a joint command. There is no riot police in the South African Police Service. I just should correct that. And there's a public order police unit. But the component consists of those components of the South African Police who work jointly with Parliament Protection Services, and the Sergeant at Arms sought the assistance of Parliament Protection Unit. And they did that at her request to assist on the instruction that a member be removed who failed to leave the House in order to do so. Thank you.
Sorry, I may inadvertently not introduce Ms. Zelda Holtzman, who's just spoken now, just for the record and for those who might not know. Ms. Zelda Holtzman is the head of Parliamentary Protection Services. Okay. I don't think the full round of questions has been answered. If we can just complete that before we take the next round.
Can we just, to the extent that censorship specifically has been mentioned, we are still to get the detail of what happened and what action was taken, at which point. You will remember, even on the occasion of August, I was told that the media were harassed and so on, and really we were hearing those things for the first time. So, but your question is whether how the issue of the cameras and the images was handled, whether it is not censorship. I guess on issues of that nature, you will always have a bit of both. Because from one point, we are looking at ensuring that we protect the image and the dignity of Parliament. That's all we're preoccupied with. We're protecting our right to proceed with the work that we're doing that we have come or have been sent to come and do here. What exactly happened, as I said, we will still sit and get reports from various angles and take the issue further. But we don't have a policy of censorship. We all know the attitude of our democracy on those matters, but all thank you very much. Once again, a very good morning to everybody, and thank you for coming. My name is Luzu Kochaikops. You are here to attend a press briefing to be addressed by the presiding officers of the National Assembly, whom I'm going to introduce you just now, to reflect on what happened in the chamber yesterday, continuing through the night. In the middle, at the table, we have got the Speaker of the National Assembly, Ms. Baleka Mbete, and to her right, we have got the Deputy Speaker of the National Assembly, Mr. Letshisa Tsenodi. And on the left-hand side of the Speaker, we have got the House Chairperson, Mr. Cedric Frolic. The Acting Secretary to Parliament is seated right next to me here. She is Ms. Baby Kiawa, and next to her is the Acting Deputy Secretary to Parliament, Advocate Modibedi Pindela. The House Secretary to the National Assembly, Mr. Masibulele Khaso, is seated just behind Advocate Pindela. Without any waste of time, I'm going to invite the Speaker of the National Assembly, Ms. Baleka Mbete, to address us. Honorable Speaker. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen of the media, any colleagues who might be here, honorable members of parliament, ladies and gentlemen. I want to do two things, speak to two things. One would focus on yesterday and give you a context of the events that then unfolded in the House. The second thing I would want to do is to perhaps just very briefly sketch a picture of the past 5 months in relation to what you also saw yesterday and give you again some commentary and some background to what was being expressed at yesterday's sitting. Yesterday was a Thursday, and therefore at 8:30 in the morning we had the usual National Assembly Program Committee, which is chaired by the Speaker. But on the eve of that meeting was a Chief Whips Forum usual meeting where the whips, you know, process the issues of programming among themselves. That's a multi-party forum. The discussion continued into the National Assembly Program Committee, in particular relating to the order of the issues that would be on the order paper. Now, only one thing for me is very specifically relevant to what then later took place, and that is the issue of clearly what was going to be a very long day. In fact, I remember that one honorable member who's a senior whip came straight to me from an opposition party and expressed great frustration. And I was saying, why? He greeted and he expressed frustration. I said, why? He then made reference to something that had just become clear to him, which he hadn't realized the day before. And that was the number of reports, the what we call budgetary review recommendation reports. So this issue of the length of time yesterday's sitting was likely to end up in was an issue that preoccupied me as I left the meeting yesterday morning. By afternoon, I had decided that, you know, if you are going to have 38 BRR reports, and every party was going to express itself, or you were going to end up with some debates, were going to be there the whole night. Hence the issue of trying to manage the issue of time. Because you always start in the day with notices of motions and motions without notice, and those are generally unlimited. So what I proposed, which is what that ruling was about, was that let's agree some time in order that we have a way of limiting this first part of the program. Because all the other items were also going to take very long, including the discussion on the report on the from the ad hoc committee that was chaired by Honorable Frolic. So this was, in fact, the point at a later stage that the parties also agreed. There was no way we were going to be able to manage time if we were going to debate all those reports. All those, in fact, in the end, there were 40 of them. So we ended up actually where I had started, to try and assist the House. And in fact, we ended up by debating only the issue relating to the treaty between South Africa and the DRC relating to the Inga Dam project. So I want to just leave the issues relating to yesterday's events there, because you probably have some information. The only thing I was doing was to give you a context, to give you some background so you understand what, in fact, was the issue of agitation, and that's what it was. The second thing which I want to pass on to relates to an observation we've been making, both from the executive authority side and from the side of the parliamentary service and those that assist us in the work that we lead here in parliament. This parliament is not yet 6 months. It's not yet 6 months. Because if you remember, we took our oath on the 21st of May. We then went away, as we always do, and we came back to listen to the State of the Nation address. And therefore, the first debate, the first formal official sitting in terms of members, you know, listening to somebody, saying something to them, and then having a debate, was in June. It was actually, to be specific, on the 17th of June. It was in that debate that the trend we have been observing started to show. And honorable people who are here will of course be aware that on that occasion, the chairperson of the National Council of Provinces had reason to actually ask some honorable members to leave the House. That was the first time in this fifth parliament. That trend has continued, and in fact, honorable members have actually said very clearly in public that they have the intention of disobeying and not cooperating with the rules and so on. So that's, in fact, the trend we have observed. And yesterday was one of many occasions when this sort of conduct, which is predetermined before people come to the House because, of course, they are pursuing a particular approach that they have taken and they've actually expressed themselves on in public. No amount of trying to accommodate honorable members has helped. No amount of invoking rules has helped. I think definitely recently, in fact last week, a voice that represents very strongly that trend has said we have no intention of cooperating. We will continue to disregard rulings. We will continue to disregard the rules. Now, Parliament is a place that works on the basis that there are certain agreed norms. There are certain agreed assumptions that all of us who come here are committing ourselves to, including the fact that we come to Parliament as people being sent through an election exercise. And we take one another as honorable members, arrive in this institution, in fact, commit ourselves through many structures that we work in, like, for instance, I made reference to you to the Chief Whip's Forum, which is a consensus-building mechanism of Parliament, which has always been respected, which always helps to make sure that we're all brought on board and together we pursue things in an agreed fashion, also as based on the rules of Parliament. Now, if you arrive and you say you are not going to respect the rules, you obviously are not in a place where you should be coming, because we come together based on an assumption that we all respect the rules until such time that we all go through a process where we agree that we need to change this rule in this way and that way. And therefore, none of us must just on our feet express ourselves or change the rules and assume that all will be well. And I think yesterday showed us what happens when you disregard the norms, when you disregard the rules, when you don't want to cooperate and you actually go all out to be disruptive and not to play according to rules of working together, which in the past four parliaments, it's not the first time I'm speaker, if people can remember. I was speaker in the third parliament, and we worked very well. And we did differ, because differing is something that happens, not even in a family, people differ. So difference is not the issue. But to take a determined, conscious position that you will not agree, you will not respect, you will not cooperate, and we have seen it ourselves. Because if you ask people who preside, they will all tell you the same thing.